wow. What a feeling. Good morning. Come on, it is exciting to be here, is it not? Good morning. Okay, we don't have to do that again. That's fabulous. Thank you so much. I'm Donald Taylor. I'm the chairman of the Learning Technologies Conference in London. I'm also your host here this morning for the opening panel. It's great to be back with a full room at the 28th edition of OEB, the world's largest, friendliest, most international conference. Let's give it up. Hello. All right. Who do we have in the room? We've got over 2,000 people. It is a fabulously international event. We've got 2,000 people, more than 2,000, from over 80 countries, from every inhabited continent. We're still working on the North and South Pole, maybe next year. We have, of course, as is traditional with OEB, to give you who are the most populous countries that have come to OEB. In fifth position, we've got a contingent from Norway. Very good. Fourth position, the UK. Third position, Denmark. Okay. The Danes are surprisingly full of energy this morning. I think they've had some coffee. Second position, Germany. And in first position, it is the Netherlands. Yes. Oh my God. They were so waiting for that moment, weren't they? Onze Nederlandse vrienden gefeliciteerd. There we go. All right, we've got a great opening session for you, a great panel coming up. Before I introduce the panel, before we get them on stage, I have some housekeeping, and I'm going to ask you a question. So firstly, very important housekeeping. We've got a packed schedule today. At the end of the day, don't miss the debate that we have in Potsdam 1. This house believes education should move to the metaverse. Yes or no? What do you think? Yes, no? All right. Nobody said, well, maybe, I'm not sure. It divides opinion. It's going to be a great debate. Please come to that. After the debate, we have drinks served in the Marlene Bar. So that's a networking evening, which means OEB pays for the drinks. All good. Let's look at the social media. This is important because I will be, while the panel is speaking, I'll be looking at Twitter to get commentary and to get your questions. Of course, when we get to the Q&A section, I'll get questions from the audience as well, but I will be looking at Twitter for any questions, so please do use #OEB22. I should point out that this is not quite the right name for the network, but it is the only network with IHG in it. So if you find a network with IHG, go for that one. That is the password. Okay. Everything else on there is all correct. Let's say a big thank you to our sponsors, because after all, they make the whole event possible. Thank you, sponsors! All right. That's the housekeeping done. What I want to do now is introduce you to the person sitting next to you, and I'm going to ask you a question. When I ask that question, I'd love you to turn to the person next to you. If you have a choice, make a new friend with somebody you don't know already, and I'd like you to answer this question in 30 seconds, then we'll get some quick feedback and press on with the panel. So the question is, what are your hopes for learning and development for 2023? We've been through some tumultuous years. What do you hope for next year? All right? 30 seconds, find a new friend, go. Oh my God. All right, let's try it. All right. Okay. At the back. You may have missed something at the back. Like an experienced facilitator, I have a way of bringing the crowd slowly to attention. I tap a glass with a spoon, but sometimes it's possible to tap too vigorously. So if you're walking around earlier, please avoid the front of the stage. Put that to one side, move on. Loads of conversation, some great points being discussed. Who wants to share something? Yeah, you're not so chatty now, are you? I just need one hand just to get us going, otherwise nothing happens. The whole conference grinds to a halt, no pressure. What do you want to happen? What are your hopes for 2023? Come on, at the front here. Quickly, yeah. And anybody else, if you've got a point, raise your hand and we'll get a microphone to run to you. Yes, go ahead.
Thank you. My hope is to reconnect with more people and be more open to learn from each other.
I love that. Isn't that a lovely sentiment? We can do it online, but isn't it also nice to do it face-to-face, to reconnect with each other and be open to learning from each other? What a wonderful idea. Anybody else got a great thought to follow on from that one for 2023? Yes? Go ahead, at the back here.
I'd like to see more AI-assisted learning and teaching and have instructors and students be more aware and use it more also.
Okay. Quick follow-up question. Why?
For me, it means the future in technology, in edtech technology also, AI. Does not mean that it's only AI. I'm just saying more and a better awareness and also not seeing it too negative as impersonal.
I love that. So it's not AI is going to conquer the world. It's another tool that we can use. Yeah, fantastic. Okay, who else do we have? It's funny, you walk in amongst the crowd and people are starting to avoid eye contact. Let's go here. So we've got, just very quickly here, Teresa, thank you. Okay, this will be the last one, because then we need to crack on with the panel. Yes?
Good. Hello. I think that, first of all, we'd like to have the victory in Ukraine, and then rebuilding it together. But, first of all, the social factor should come back, as we discussed with the group, with the colleagues, and as well as inclusiveness. More target audience should be covered with the technologies as well.
So let's have inclusivity, let's have sociability, and let's have peace. I love that common theme. We have a common theme of technology, we also have a common theme of people there, and I think that's something which is going to be a theme that goes through the conference. Thanks for your thoughts there. Look, we could chat, but I think you want me to get off the stage and introduce our panel so we can get going with the rest of the day. Let's do that. Our panel is... As always, an international panel, we've got David Mattin from New World's Same Humans. We've got Njeri Mwagiru from Stellenbosch University, the Institute for Futures Research. And we've got Per Lager, who is from the Defense University in Sweden. Ladies and gentlemen, everybody, please welcome your panel to the stage. Give it up for them, yeah. David's going to give us an overview of what's changing in workplace learning and learning generally in higher ed as well. And Jerry is going to ask us then to think about how we think about the future. So we often take the future as being something that happens to us. Well, perhaps we could anticipate or think about the future in a way that enables us to be more proactive about it. And finally, Per will have a look at how can we build a learning culture in our organization. It's going to be a great panel. We're going to go through, each person will talk for about 15 minutes. I'll be watching Twitter for any questions. We will also, at the end, have microphones roaming in the audience for questions. and then we'll have a question and answer session, which will last from probably about 10:30 through to 11 o'clock. That's it. I'm ready for the panel. I hope you are too. David, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Don, thank you for that amazing introduction. It's so great to be speaking to you. Thanks for having me. My name, as you just heard, is David. I write a newsletter on trends, technology, and our shared future called New World, Same Humans. I speak to organizations about what's coming next and what it means for them. And my obsession really is trends. I am obsessed with the trends reshaping mindsets, behaviors, expectations all over the world. Now, we, of course, in this room are learning people, we're education people. So I have chosen three big trends that I want to put on your radar in this quick session. These are trends that I talk about in all kinds of contexts to all kinds of people, but I think they are super powerful for you. I think they have deep implications for education and learning. So that's what this session is all about. Three trends that I want to put on your radar. I'm going to go pretty fast. It's going to be a big download of information. I'm going to touch on themes that we've already touched on in the audience participation. Someone mentioned AI. A lot of people mentioned getting back together. We did talk about the metaverse, and I am going to talk about that too. There'll be a chance for questions at the end, of course, and I'm going to touch on themes that you will hear from across the next day from a whole range of amazing speakers, including, of course, the two on stage right now. Right. With all that said, let's get into it. What I really hope that you take away from this 15 minutes are trends and ideas that you can use. I'd love you to take these trends away and put them to use in 2023. So with all that said, let's race on to trend number one. Trend number one is going to speak to that person who said they'd like to see more AI, AI as a tool in learning, because it starts with that idea. We live in a world right now of AI-fueled assistants, things like Siri and Alexa. And hundreds of millions of people have conversations with those assistants all the time. They are very functional, transactional conversations on the whole. They're things like Siri, you know, where's the nearest bank? Alexa, order me some washing powder. But something interesting is happening now. Our relationship with those AI-fueled entities is changing. It's becoming about higher order human needs beyond transaction and functionality, human needs like happiness, creativity, even companionship. People are starting to turn to AI-fueled entities as companions, as friends. Now, if that sounds too science fiction for you, just ask yourself, have you ever asked Siri or Alexa or an AI a question with any emotional content at all? If you have, then you're already starting to admit to yourself that this world is emerging, a world of virtual companions. That's the name of this first trend, virtual companions, AI-fueled entities that we relate to on a deeper level. Now look, before I get into what this means for education, I want to give you an example of what I mean. Here's an example I talk about all the time. This is Replica. Replica is an AI-fueled chatbot that essentially wants to become your best friend and your counselor. If you find the idea of a virtual companion, an AI-fueled entity that becomes a friend or a companion, if you find that idea hard to believe in, download this app. Give it a try. Essentially, you talk to this app. You can type or you can just speak. It understands spoken language. It asks you a ton of questions about yourself. And over time, what it's aiming to do is learn about you and then become something of a mirror image of your personality, a replica of your personality, so that when you talk to it, you can learn about yourself from Replica. Millions of people downloaded this app during the pandemic. And if you give it a try, it's quite stilted at first, but there does start to become something quite eerie, quite strange about your conversations with this AI-fueled chatbot. Now look, I've been talking about virtual companions for years, and I've been standing on stages and saying, they're coming, we're entering this new age of virtual companions. We saw the arrival across the last couple of years of a technology that will transform this trend, that will really mark the arrival of virtual companions. And I'm talking, of course, about this. transformer models, large language models, including this one that many of you will have heard of, GPT-3. Transformer models are a revolutionary new kind of neural network. They spot patterns in sequential data. It gets very technical, but essentially one of the upshots of all that is these AIs are incredible at understanding language and outputting language. You can have a conversation with GPT-3, and it is very hard often to know or detect that you are not speaking to a human being. And that is going to take virtual companions, the arrival of these AI-fueled conversational entities, to a whole new level. Look at this. This launched just a couple of months ago. This is a startup called Character AI. Character AI is using a large language model, one of these AIs I'm talking about, to develop conversational entities, AI-fueled entities, based on historical figures. So one of them is Socrates. They've taken a large language model, they've trained it on all the sayings of Socrates, imparted to us by Plato, obviously, and now you can have a conversation with this AI Socrates. So I logged in the other day and asked Socrates, what is the meaning of life? Okay, I thought I'd start with a difficult question. And you can see that the output is pretty convincing. It sounds like the kind of thing, the examined life is the meaningful life, sounds like the kind of thing Socrates would have said. The two engineers behind this created Lambda, the large language model that Google is using as a rival to GPT-3. So this is absolutely cutting-edge AI technology. What does it mean for education? It goes back to what that audience member said before this session started. We are entering an age of AI-fueled learning companions. My challenge to you is, what does it mean for the future of education and learning? How does it change education and learning when you can learn philosophy by speaking to an AI-fueled Socrates? How do you learn physics when you can speak to an AI Isaac Newton? How do you learn psychology when you can speak to an AI-fueled Freud? And actually, you can speak to a Sigmund Freud using Character AI. They've trained the AI on all the books of Sigmund Freud. You can go and have a conversation with Sigmund Freud there. Now look, I speak about this trend in all kinds of contexts. I put it in front of all kinds of organizations and all kinds of professionals, but I think this has deep implications for people like you. It is a new kind of learning and education tool. We are going to be able to deploy AI-fueled conversational entities to help educate people in all kinds of subjects in new and innovative and engaging ways. There are two challenges associated with this trend, and I'm sure we'll talk much more about all of that. The first is, these large language models, you can't just have a conversation with them. They can also output extremely convincing human-like text. So you can say to GPT-3, write me a short poem about a wise frog, and it will just generate that, and it will generate that in seconds. I mean, it's not T.S. Eliot, but given that it was generated in about 10 seconds, you know, it's pretty good. And we're already here. I read a huge article about this the other day. We're already hearing teachers and university lecturers saying, my students are using GPT-3 to do their homework, basically. That is a big challenge. What are we going to do about it? The second, perhaps even more significant structural challenge, and again, this goes back to what we heard from you earlier on, if people start to believe that these AI-fueled conversational entities can be in any way a replacement for the unique magic that is contact with another human being, contact with another human teacher, okay, and the incredible power of that, then in my view, and I contend many of you would agree, we are somewhat lost. We have lost our way. These can be a hugely powerful tool. The challenge for us and for people like you especially is how do we use that tool and use it to liberate teachers, human beings, to do what only they can do, which is be a real human being in a room with other human beings. That will always be the center of education and learning, and the power of that will never be diminished. But I would love you to think about the rise of AI-fueled entities, just like the ones I've shown you, and what that means for the future of education and learning. the opportunities and the challenges it offers you. Okay, racing on to trend number two. We can deal with this one pretty quickly. And this goes to what we heard in the room about getting people back together. The pandemic threw up huge questions about the future of work. We've landed kind of in this place, in a place of hybrid work, sometimes working remotely, sometimes working in an office. That means a lot of work meetings look like this now. Okay, and that's a problem because we're losing something. When we think about workplace education and training, we tend to port over the model from school and our university years. We think about programmatic, formal learning, you know, training programs, staff away days, executive education. But so much knowledge in an organization, in a workplace, is embedded in informal networks throughout the organization. It's spread across people, hundreds or thousands of them. And so much learning happens in totally informal, spontaneous, impromptu ways. You know, bumping into someone in the corridor, having a coffee break, just watching someone work and learning from them, making a mistake and asking for help. And in a hybrid work world or a remote work world, we're losing those spontaneous, informal learning moments. So I think we're going to see organizations go on a quest to reboot those moments, to get back moments of informal learning, to recover the knowledge that is structured informally through the organization. It's about rebooting what I call the chit-chat economy, just having informal chats with your colleagues. Two very quick examples to show you what I mean. One a tiny example, one a very big example. Here's the tiny example. This is Random Coffee. It's a platform that is incredibly simple. All it does is wire itself into your organization and spontaneously organize coffee meetings between colleagues. It's just a very simple tool to get colleagues to meet for coffee when otherwise they wouldn't. And it will have access to everyone's calendar, it will suggest appointments, get people together for coffee. It's so simple, I mean, such a simple tool, but I think the power of that and examples like this for people like you, it's sending a signal to us about this need to reboot moments of informal learning. I mean, I'm not showing you any of these examples to say this is the next unicorn in the education space. This is what we should invest our money in. This will become famous. No, I'm showing it to you as a signal of where things are heading. And I think we'll see many more tools like this that are about rebooting moments of informal contact. I also think we're going to see a lot more of this. This is Salesforce essentially building a massive resort, a massive hotel, to persuade its people to come back together. I have a very quick video just to give you a texture of it. Check this out.
Welcome to Basecamp at Salesforce's own Trailblazer Ranch. We are excited to invite you to apply to our exclusive new candidate retreat happening in Scotts Valley, California. And don't worry, all travel and accommodation expenses will be covered by us for accepted applicants. This is a world-class immersive experience aimed at allowing you to get to know Salesforce on a whole new level. You'll spend the week staying at our all-expenses-paid, luxurious Trailblazer Ranch in Scotts Valley, California, eating fresh farm-to-table meals and doing all kinds of fun, immersive activities. We can't wait for you to join us at Basecamp to learn about Salesforce, our culture, imagine a future with us, and most importantly, have fun. So make sure you apply by the deadline.
Okay, you get the idea. Now look, I put that example in front of obviously a lot of hospitality organizations. I put it in front of banks and insurance organizations to say this is what other organizations are doing to bring their colleagues back together, to persuade, quite frankly, some of their young people to actually sit in a room with one another. I'm putting it in front of you to say this is part of the future of corporate learning and education and training. We are going to see massive corporations locations, building huge sprawling hotel, what we used to call hotel resorts, to bring their people back together and offer learning and training programs, yeah, sure, but also informal moments of learning and training. So that is my challenge again to you. How can people like you empower big organizations, you know, corporations, governmental organizations, to reboot those moments of informal, spontaneous learning, to recover that knowledge that's embedded across the organization that just doesn't get transmitted, that doesn't rub off on people via that weekly Zoom call? That is a huge challenge. It's perhaps the primary challenge for big organizations in the 2020s. We're losing a ton of knowledge and knowledge exchange if we just sit on Zoom. Zoom is great, there's a lot of power in being online, but we lose something, and how can we reboot it? That's the question for this room. Right, final trend before I wrap up. I can't stand on this stage without mentioning this word. There's been a huge amount of hype across the last 12 to 24 months. The metaverse. A lot of the skepticism is very justified, but I want to take a quick look at how virtual worlds are set to impact the future of learning and education. First, like a very quick definition of the metaverse, because the word gets used all kinds of ways. What do we really mean? I think the most fruitful definition of the metaverse is simply virtual world, sometimes video games, sometimes virtual reality or augmented reality, virtual worlds where people are having experiences that are as meaningful to them as the experiences they have in the world out there, that are as meaningful to them, in some sense, as real to them as the experiences they have in the real world. An internet of experiences is a great way of thinking about the metaverse. So I talk a lot these days to all kinds of organizations about the metaversal self. Virtual worlds as domains where people will quest after their fundamental human needs, convenience, security, value, just as they do in the world around us. But what does this mean for education and learning? Well, the metaverse will have an impact on workplace education and training. There's no doubt about that. A lot of the skepticism is justified, but here is an example where I think the power is undeniable. So you have NHS trusts in London using virtual reality now to train the next generation of surgeons. Really powerful new form of training for surgeons. Warning on this video, if you've just had breakfast, it's only cartoons, it's not real people. I just want to give you a taste of what it looks like. So you have surgeons being trained in these virtual reality environments, and in London, they just use this virtual reality environment to facilitate an operation where they separated conjoined twins. The surgeons trained in the virtual reality environment for 6 months before, yeah, it gets pretty gory, I'm gonna go. You've seen enough. They trained in the virtual reality environment for 6 months before they did this operation. And the operation was conducted in Rio de Janeiro in the end, but with surgeons in London in a virtual reality environment guiding the surgeons in Rio. So there is no denying the power of that. Virtual reality environments will be hugely powerful for education, learning, and training, especially in professions and domains where the operation of three-dimensional models and three-dimensional space is crucial. Finally, to wrap up, we can think more about education and learning for young people. How will the metaverse play out there? This is the example that got a lot of people talking about the metaverse. This was a huge concert inside the video game Fortnite in 2020. 8 million people joined live to watch that concert, and this is what prompted people to say, wow, like Fortnite is more than just a game. Fortnite is a world where people are coming to have experiences that are truly meaningful to them. This is a concert, 8 million people watched it. It was meaningful to them. Look what's happening inside Fortnite right now. This is my final example. This is a gallery in Kensington in London called the Serpentine Gallery, very prestigious fine art gallery. And it recently hosted an exhibition by this guy. He's a US street artist called Cause. He does graffiti and he does sculptures. But the Serpentine Gallery partnered with Fortnite to build a mirror image of this exhibition inside the game. Okay? So anyone could jump inside Fortnite and visit the Serpentine Gallery inside Fortnite to see the Kors exhibition. And if you listen to Kors, it's very interesting. He says, look, I'm a guy in my mid-40s. I'm an artist. For me, there is no replacement for physical contact with art, physical contact with the sculpture or the painting. But I have to accept that millions of young people are living their lives partly inside virtual worlds, inside places like Fortnite. And I hope I can bring my art to those people too in this way. I hope it will inspire some of them to want to come and see art in real life too. I'm showing this to you because this kind of immersive experience, I think we'd all agree this is educational, this is edifying. This kind of immersive experience, even inside video games like Fortnite, the type of thing, if you're anything like me, you're trying to persuade your children not to spend all their time inside. But even inside video games like Fortnite, we will see immersive, engaging, learning and education experiences. And again, the challenge for people like you is how do you make sense of that? What opportunities does it offer you? What threats does it offer you? But how could you go out and build engaging, immersive learning experiences like that one, cultural experiences, inside virtual worlds where millions, hundreds of millions of young people already are? Okay. That is more than enough for me. I hope those trends are useful. We're going to talk a whole lot more about them across the day. Take them away. Use them. Like I said, trends are useless if you just know them. You have to do something with them. So use them. But that's more than enough for me for now. Thank you so much for listening. Thanks.
Thank you. David, say that. Great.
Thank you.
Great start. Great start. Good questions coming in already from Robin and Rob, so thank you for that on Twitter. I'm going to ask those, I think, at the end. I just want to quickly follow up on the metaverse there, quickly.
Yes.
By the way, the skeleton was running through the gallery very fast. That's a bit like me when it's coming up to lunchtime. I need to see the art, but I want to get to the pasta as well. So I've got a quick run through, then down the trattoria. So, metaverse, we've got the debate this evening. All education should be moved to the metaverse, yes or no?
Clearly no.
You can't
no.
say, yep.
Clearly no.
No.
Not all, no. Clearly not all, not even most. And I mean, I hope it's clear from the tone of my talk. Again, whoever, you know, spoke from the audience really nailed it. It's a tool.
Right.
The metaverse, you know, those AI-fueled entities, they're a new tool. The metaverse is a new domain. It's a new space we can use.
Right.
The challenge is then to think, how do we use it intelligently?
Right.
When should we use it? When should we not? You know,
I like the message.
Yeah.
There's an awful lot of black and white thinking often in our field. It has to be one thing or the other. Actually, usually the answer is somewhere in the middle. David, thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Next up, we've got Njeri and Mwagiru from the Institute for Futures Research at Stellenbosch University. Njeri, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Wow. Good morning. I am absolutely thrilled and honored to be a part of this panel for the starting plenary of OEB 2022. I have traveled a long way from Cape Town, South Africa, and first and foremost, as I look at this full room brimming at the edges, my hearty congratulations. Let me join Don in first and foremost acknowledging the founders of this fantastic gathering and, of course, the organizers for maintaining the momentum and catalyzing us all here. And, of course, to yourselves, thank you for being here. And I hope that we can have rich conversations and make this a valuable time. So a few remarks from me that I hope can contribute some sparks to ignite the conversations, the networks, and the collaboration that can possibly be the avenues that create new ideas, that bring new innovations. And these can potentially be the seeds that shape new futures of learning. So the new futures of learning seeds are here with us. Thinking about futures, shaping futures, future studies is part of the work I do at the Institute for Futures Research based at Stellenbosch University Business School. And I also lecture on the academic program, the only academic program on future studies offered across the 55 African states on the continent of Africa. We value this position highly. And what we do is we build competencies. We have a range of programs. We have a one-year postgraduate diploma. We have a master's in philosophy in future studies. And we have a doctoral program in future studies as well. I highlight this because I want us to think seriously about futures. So we build competencies, we grow professional, qualified futurists with the skill set to be able to deal with complexity and rapid change, and especially to create desirable futures. And we do this across a range of industries, themes, sectors, and we work with a range of clients in public and private sector at community and individual level to think around how do we respond to the amazing trends and changes in the world around us, as David has highlighted some very key ones with relevance to futures of learning. So in thinking about shaping futures of learning, I would like to highlight three critical factors for our consideration, which I believe are important as we think around what the future may bring. And these are access, content, and application. And I want us to think around some questions. David already posted some interesting questions for us to reflect on in his remarks. And I want to add to that. I want us to think around, where is learning accessed? Which content is privileged? And what are the systems and support mechanisms that exist for application? Okay? It's also helpful as we think around futures of learning to reflect on these questions and consider access, content, and application with reference to the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which give us an international framework, an agenda to pursue and achieve futures we want as per the agreement of our leaders through the United Nations system. And especially UNSDG 4, Goal 4, which focuses on ensuring inclusive and equitable quality education and promoting lifelong learning opportunities for all. Ideally, by 2030, that is in 7 years' time. Okay, so quite a near-term future from a futures perspective. And then also in thinking about shaping futures, I want us to importantly recognize, as we all know, that we live in phenomenally interesting times of exponential, rapid change that's driven by shifts across our environment, technological, political, economic, and social domains. And these times are bringing us both phenomenal opportunities as well as risks. And a key challenge in shaping futures of learning is how we respond to this. Change is a key challenge, but it is not an insurmountable challenge. So in a world that is volatile, uncertain, complex, ambiguous, futures thinking, strategic foresight offers us tools to be able to make sense of this world, to listen to David, and to begin to interpret these signals, these trends that we observe in the world around us, and anticipate what they mean for us in our spaces, in our professional and personal lives, at a community and individual level. And finally, to take action. As David said, apply, apply, apply. Apply yourself to these trends. Let's take action and shape these futures of learning, specifically proactively. A caution. Futures thinking and strategic foresight is not about predicting the future. The future is unknown. It is impossible to know what's going to happen in the future, even with the amazing predictive technologies and data analytic capabilities that we are beginning to develop. Let me quote the founder of our institute, Prof. Spies. We were established in 1974, and he says the ultimate purpose in thinking about futures is not to predict the future, but rather to create a desired future. and through better foresight development, through better thinking about the future, to make better long-term decisions. So in dealing with complexity and uncertainty, the aim is not to be right in what can happen, but rather to be better prepared. And another caution, there is not one single future. There are multiple futures available to us. So in shaping futures of learning, the focus is not on what will happen, we can't predict the future, but rather what can happen, what could happen, what kinds of actions could we take to realize a range of different multiple possible futures. And there's not one single trajectory from today into tomorrow, but rather multiple potentialities that can unfold. And we have agency in this. In futures thinking, we emphasize that although we can't predict the future, the seeds of possible futures exist today. And what we can do is exercise our agency, take action, make relevant decisions that allow us to have some influence over the future, to engage with the trends in a way that allows us to create futures that we want. So the seeds of the future exist today, and we can play a role in that. So building on those futures thinking principles, let's consider the three critical factors of access, content, and application. First and foremost, access. We can see in the world around us, and as David has shown with some of those trends, you can access learning through very many different contexts, in different places, at different times, in diverse ways. And yet, the issue of inclusivity, engagement, and participation continues to be a challenge. So how can we shape futures of learning in a way that broadens access so that these futures of learning are collectively owned, collectively shared? And how do we ensure that in shaping these futures of learning, as we think about our facilities, both brick and mortar, but also online and cyber worlds, that we understand who is the audience we're targeting and which spaces do they occupy, whether it's the youth in the metaverse or senior citizens or rural communities? And which sites of learning are centered? And how can we decenter sites of learning that don't allow for access? Or how can we broaden the centers of learning to ensure that we have much more inclusivity in our futures? However, access to what content? The value of relevance and quality, and I speak as an academic, continue. We must ensure that the content we're generating, the content we're sharing, the content we're providing access to is quality content and relevant for the users and the learners and those that will apply the ideas that we're sharing. In a 4IR world, in a digitizing world, in the fourth industrial revolution, there's a huge emphasis on STEM, science, technology, engineering, maths, and of course, this is very important as we think about new worlds of work and emerging futures of society. But also there's increasing focus on experiential learning, embedded learning, learning that allows us to work on the job, to continue learning throughout our lives. And the arts, not only as a foundation for creativity, which is a critical skill for emerging futures and in shaping futures of learning, but also as a center point for developing other critical competencies that are people-oriented. And this is helping us build connection through the arts, relationships across our learning cohorts, and empathy across different worldviews, different perspectives, different experiences. And in an increasingly crisis-oriented world, the skills of initiative, innovation, and resilience are coming to the fore as well. And what about application of learning and the tools of application that are available for us in our learning worlds? Well, the big buzzwords, as we know, is digital transformation. And there's a broad range of ICT trends. We're going to hear about quite a few of them, I think, in the multiple talks and presentations that will be taking place during this conference. These include extended reality, virtual reality, data analytics, big data, tutor bots, social media, gaming, a whole range of trends. Digital trends are absolutely changing worlds of work. They are creating new worlds of learning and altogether new worlds if we think about the metaverse. And I really look forward to the debate later on today. Definitely a lot to think around there. But at the same time, there are risks and challenges that come with these transformations. These transformations are not automatically positive outcomes oriented. Rather, it's about how we engage with these trends, how we apply ourselves to ensure we shape these trends and their potential towards futures that we want. And in a world of a massive digital divide, where 2 billion people continue to be disconnected from digital worlds, we need to remember that multiple futures are possible. A tech-based future is only one future. There are many futures possible, and it would be interesting to observe and to anticipate what futures might emerge across the 2 billion who are not connected to the internet. What futures do they aspire to? And how can tech-based innovations interlace and connect to help these become a reality? We have massive reach and impact. But in a world where there are increasing crises, we also need to keep in mind that a digital world is precarious. There's a cold war of technology brimming across geopolitical domains with the main dominant powers. There's issues around regulation, resources, sharing, intellectual property. The digital world, their foundations remain quite loose. So let's keep our minds open as we think around multiple possible futures. So here we are at this conference, global conference in 2022. And I invite us, as we think around shaping futures of learning, to consider new futures frames, broad futures frames, frames that allow us to think of multiple possibilities that can emerge. So let's engage with each other, with our ideas, connect the dots, ask the questions, or perhaps reframe the questions. And importantly, utilize our agency to push the boundaries, to expand our imagination, to build on what we know, on the experience we have, in order to broaden and deepen our analysis, and through engagement across a global gathering of people, use different lenses to view the world, use different perspectives to understand what could be and how what could be could come about. So, futures of learning are ours to shape. Futures of learning are ours to shape. They're not happening to us. We are creating them and building them. But walking the path from potentiality to actuality is not straightforward. It's not straightforward. It takes work. And that's why we're here, right? We're here to work. And work together to learn, to unlearn, to imagine, to reimagine, to think around the supportive, conducive structures, systems, processes necessary to actually realize potential and create the futures that we want, and especially to apply our agency and action. So let's create our futures. Let's mobilize in this unique moment, in this fantastic gathering with all of these colleagues and peers from across the world to think about what's possible. The seeds of futures are here today. How we nurture them and what these seeds grow to become and which futures become realized is a lifelong journey, and it's a life-wide journey. I'm excited about our futures. I hope you are too. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I love the combination here of a positive message that the future is ours to determine and also the subtle challenge. It isn't quite as simple as we think, and perhaps we need to get outside our boxes and look at it from a new lens. One question from, I think, Philip in the audience, or Philippe. If we can't predict the future, how do we prepare for it? Now, Philip said, how do we prepare our teachers for it? But how do we prepare at all for it if we can't predict it? Very quickly.
So how we prepare for it is by keeping track of the signals of change, the trends, the drivers of change that are happening in the world around us, engaging multiple perspectives in terms of what we think can be possible, and preparing across a broad range of possibilities so we don't lock ourselves down when a crisis comes, we're not able to respond. So we prepare by engaging with the information available to us, engaging with the expertise and the competencies that know the sectors we're interested in, and in preparing across multiple possibilities.
So scan the horizon, perhaps talk with other people about the route to get there.
Yep.
Be prepared to be agile on the journey.
Absolutely.
Brilliant. Njeri, thank you so much.
Pleasure.
All right. Finally, we're going from the big picture down to the detail. We've got Per Lager talking us through how, well, a complex presentation, but boiling down, how to produce a culture of learning in your organization. Per.
Thank you so much. It's a great, great honor and pleasure being here. Despite being a little bit nervous, so thank you for sitting here on, letting me sitting here on stage for 1 hour to feel the anxiety, you know, bubbling in the body. So I'm Per Lager from the Swedish Defense University. Thank you, David. Thank you, Njeri. Talking about Njeri, I mean, I just found out that her name means relative of a warrior or the traveler. And Per Lager, I'm named after a bear. So that's a little bit like a comparison. So thank you. So, once again, it's just a great pleasure being here. I was here in person 9 years ago. It was an extraordinary experience for me. I remember meeting a professor from MIT, he was just about 70 years old, talking about how he used new technology to work as the instructor and teacher he has always wanted to be. So when I went home, I was running a big education group there in the Nordic Sweden, and I said, you know, using edtech has nothing to do with age. It has everything to do with pedagogics. So thank you for inspiring me there. And then I also met the learning and development director for Volvo Cars. He was from Belgium, building the new factory in China, recruiting a lot of people. But not only that, he had to educate all the new workforce in a very short amount of time. So from that learning experience, I went home to Stockholm and I founded a company working with accelerated learning that are still around also here in Germany. So I would like to talk to you about how you can build a learning culture. I've been studying organizations that have managed to build that learning culture. You know, less than 10% of the organizations in the world have reached what you can say or call or define as a learning culture. So I've studied them and, of course, went to through a lot of research on learning culture. That's what I would like to share with you today, and I've written a book about that. But before I go into that, I mean, being here at Online Educa in Berlin, maybe for 1, 2, or even 3 days, is a lot of opportunities for learning. But you know, learning doesn't just happen randomly. You have to make it happen, to make go from that common sense into common practice. And I use a very simple, straightforward model, and that is this. So when I have the opportunity to learn, I structure the learning around these three questions. From what I've learned from colleagues or presentations or workers, what should I continue to do? Or even do more of that I hear from there? So I put down a couple of things there. And then, of course, to do the hardest thing, to stop to do stuff. I've learned, I come to the understanding, I take that Band-Aid off because I got inspiration and new knowledge from you guys. So I can put down a couple of things that I should stop to do when I get home. And then, of course, to put down one or two things that I should start to do. So that's a very simple, straightforward forward. No rocket science there, is it? But the rocket science comes from going from the common sense that I put down into common practice, meaning making it happen when you get home. So, find your structure for learning, taking all the opportunities you have here, but it will not come automatically. So, I'm talking about building a learning culture. Why? Well, I love this quote from Jack Welch. When the rate of change outside your organization exceeds the rate of change inside, the end is in sight. So building a learning culture, from my point of view, is on one hand for you inside your organizations to make sure that you have a learning culture. And then for many of you to also help other organizations build that learning culture, because all of us need help in building a learning culture. And then we have this one. Many experts from IBM Research and Deloitte Research said that the half-life of knowledge is now down to 5 years, meaning what we know today is only worth 50% in 5 years. So standing still, relying on your PhD, whatever, it's not standing still, it's moving back. And then you can ask yourself, so how much of learning do we need to practice or implement? Well, World Economic Forum, you know, they have had our field, education, learning, on the top of the agenda for the last 5-6 years. And their research showed that an average worker needs to spend 25 days of learning per year in order to keep up. So then you can just reflect how many days of structured, planned learning do you have in your organization? Normally, if you look into Eurostat, you spend around 30 minutes of structured learning every week, and that need to go up to 5 hours a week in order to keep up, to make use of all the trends there that we have, in order to make the SDGs happen in the year 2030. So, this was my introduction. Maybe we have greater challenges than ever before. We need to learn more than ever. The beauty, and that we will see here for this 3-day event, is that we have greater opportunities than ever. But when I usually give talks to organizations, I ask them, what is hindering you? Why only this 30 minutes a day? Why haven't we reached the 5 hours? And it's this three. 75% of all answers, I use Mentimeters, I have more than 100,000 answers, they say time. So 70% say time. Even though they regard themselves as a knowledge organization, it's still time that is hindering them. You know, it should be impossible, but it is. But then, it's what, okay, I understand that I should learn. That, you know, the world is changing, but what should I learn? Is it like digitalization, but is it like AI, or is it Excel spreadsheet? What should I learn? To become concrete, that takes me somewhere. And the third thing is, how should I learn? Should I learn like we have always done it? You know, every fourth year, going out to a fancy location for a 2-day workshop, whatever. Or could we do learning in a more impactful way? So, World Economic Forum, I think it's like 7 years ago, when they start to focus even more on industrialization 4.0, they start to talk about reskill and upskill. Instead of only using the term lifelong learning. I love the term lifelong learning, but sometimes it gets a little bit blurry. Everybody is for lifelong learning, but what do you actually do? And here I think we can get use of the term upskill and reskill, because it's a little bit more concrete. You know, the upskill is for the jobs that will be around also in the future. Maybe in the next 10 years, 50% of the jobs as we know them will still be around. But even more complex. So we need to have a structured way to keep up. And that's the upskilling, the conscious way to work with learning all of the time, not only every fourth year. But that's not enough, because 50%, if you agree, of all jobs may disappear in the coming years. That's why we need the reskilling. Take your experiences, your knowledge, the know-how that you have for the job that you have today but will not be around tomorrow, and get new competences in order, when you're 45 or even as me, over 50, to use your knowledge but get new competences to go into a brand new job. That's much tougher. So we need to work with both things. So, I have designed a 5-step model. It comes from the experience from meeting a lot of organizations that has been successful in creating a learning culture, and from research. So in the middle, you have all these connections in the brain, you know, that makes the brain grow. So it is to use learning to develop in order to reach results. Maybe the most important thing is to reach the SDGs, the Strategic Development Goals. But around that, I have identified things that organizations have in common, those organizations that have designed or created a culture of learning. And the first one is to light your lighthouse, to know in what direction you are heading. The second is to have a learning mindset and to strengthen the learning mindset in the organization. Thirdly, to do the right needs analysis. What do we actually need to learn? And to create a learning policy so you make learning impactful in organization. When you have these three in place, then you can start to throw in activities. Then you can work with your LMS powered by AI and all the non-modules, whatever. But I think we should focus on the everyday learning first. And then, of course, with education and training. So I will wrap up with giving you a couple of examples in each step. The lighthouse, most important, to know where are we heading as an organization. To light that lighthouse so everybody in the organization know where we are heading. Oh, so we're heading in that direction. I see the lighthouse there at the end of the horizon. So it's in that direction that I should learn, that we should learn, and not in that direction, because we can't learn everything. So it gives you clear direction. Of course, you have to add, you know, the Simon Sinek's why. Why should we go there? What happens when we reach the goal? But then you have a clear learning path. This is important. Very few organizations have this clear lighthouse. So the employees don't know where to head and what to learn. Light it. Light the lighthouse. Second, the learning mindsets. Use, I love Carol Dweck, by the way, to use the growth mindsets as a foundation, but it's not enough. I think the learning mindsets is about a discussion with yourself between the employee and the manager, and between HR and the staff. Why do I learn? Why do I need to learn? Why do I want to learn? I think it's a conversation in an organization that we simply do too little of. Then secondly, ask yourself, how do I learn in the best of ways? Because that we learn a little bit different way, of course. I will not go into the study of learning styles. You know, it will be like a hand fight. But we need to really understand how I learn in the best way. And to find out and to make sure that you prioritize the way that really helps you going forward and avoid all the other stuff that maybe are fruitful for someone else, but not for you. Second, what do I need to learn? To be precise, to know that. And if you don't have the lighthouse, it's really hard. Then, to make sure that everybody are aware of all the opportunities inside the organization, with great colleagues, smart colleagues, site visits, non-courses, whatever, onboarding programs, but also outside. When I ask, still in the year 2022, when I ask the audience, well-educated audiences around in Europe mostly, how many of you know what a MOOC is? It's like below 15% that know what it is. It's like 15 years ago that we saw the first MOOC. It's not simply good enough. So make sure that everybody knows about the opportunities. And then habits, to create habits for everyday learning. How can you do that? One thing is to work with needs analysis, to have a conversation with your manager asking two questions. First, not firstly talk about learning, but first is talk about change. What are the new demands in your role? Is it like many new demands coming from outside or coming from inside, or very few? And then, secondly, connect that, what is happening with your role, with the competence. Do I have all the competencies, or do I lack? You can even throw in, like I have designed in the book, a scale here running from 1 to 10. 10, meaning a lot of things is happening. New client demands, the AI shift, the metaverse, and also I have a new job assignments internally. 10. And 10, I don't have the competencies in order to work with metaverse. So up here is a great demand. And of course, you can use AI for a tool to get help with this, like SAP is doing, you know, an algorithm that follows what you have, what you know, and to make the gap analysis what you need to know in order to reach the company's overall missions. And then the everyday learning. When they have the foundation, then you can go into the everyday learning. But then, I think it's so important to use your selective perception to make the everyday learning go from being reactive to proactive, from unplanned to planned to make it conscious by asking yourselves, what do I need to learn in this quarter? To use the selective perception. The brain is just amazing. Instead of just randomly letting everyday learning happen, maybe. And then use one very straightforward model. I've stolen this from McKinsey. And they say, use this model. Choose 3 learning goals, not 1, not 10. Have a 3-month deadline, not a year, not a week. And involve 3 other people in your learning, a study buddy, maybe 2 study buddies, and your manager. Then you can make learning happen. And then, the learning strategy. Many of us use the 70-20-10 rule, don't we? You know, a lot of things when it comes to learning happens inside your normal working role, and only 10% on courses and stuff like that. I think it's very beneficial for everyday learning. But how many of you have really studied what the figures come from? What research are behind the 70-20-10 rule that so many are using? That's a tip. Look it up. Because sometimes it's the other way around. Because if you don't have the knowledge of metaverse, how can you learn it from colleagues? It's impossible. Then you need to go outside your organization in order to get the new knowledge in order to keep up with everything that's happening. So, last slide. Everything sums up to how can we use this 5 perspective, adding a 6th perspective maybe, or something like that, in building your own academy in your organization. Or, for you who are our providers, how can you help organizations build their own learning academy, getting used to everything that's happening outside, because very few know about the education revolution out there. Thank you.
Fantastic. Okay. Per, I'm gonna go straight into questions for the panel now, so please take a seat. We've had a couple of notes on Twitter that there's a lot of people in the room. It's getting kind of airless. I'm just wondering, could we open up the doors, maybe encourage some air to come through? We've got 15 minutes of Q&A. Let's have the doors open so we can get some ventilation going. Great observation from Alejandro via tweet. We're talking a lot about skills. My own survey, which I run each year, shows that reskilling and upskilling is the dominant force in people's thinking for the past 2 years. Panel, are we at risk of putting too much emphasis on skills and not enough on a good basis of knowledge, whether it's in the workplace or in education? Per, let's start with you, because you were strong on reskilling and upskilling. It's the title of your book, after all.
Thank you so much for that easy question. how much time do we have? No, it's... This is talking in front of this audience also. I think it's quite tricky because, of course, you need both.
Yeah, of course. And
many of us talk about the power skills, the soft skills. But I think I would like to throw a question right back, or maybe an idea right back. I think, like World Economic Forum, on second place on the most important skill is the skill of learning how to learn. McKinsey rated number 1. European Commission rated on top 7. I think that maybe is more important. The skill to learn, the passion to learn, and to get to know your own learning. And I just must say that for those who haven't taken the course, Learning How to Learn with Barbara Oakley, hands up, how many have taken the course on Coursera? Learning How to Learn?
Whose course is this?
I think University of San Diego.
Right, yeah.
3.4 million people in the world has taken the course, have taken the responsibility to make yourself a better learner. I think that is the most important.
Okay, so you've taken a very political answer there. You haven't actually answered the question, which was skills or knowledge, but you've given a very good answer, which is a fundamental thing that underpins both of them. You can learn a skill and you can still learn knowledge if you have the skill of...
And you know I have a background in politics, so thank you.
any thoughts, Njeri, any thoughts on knowledge, skills? Are we in danger of not putting enough emphasis on knowledge?
Yes, so let me second what my colleague has said here on the panel. I do think it's a matter of both. I also think it's very important when we focus on skills and keeping in mind the possibility of multiple futures that we remain flexible in how we learn about skills, what skills we prioritize as well. So I think it's important to center skills, center learning, and to remain flexible even in how we do that.
Fantastic. Yeah. David, have you seen any thoughts about knowledge in all of your horizon scanning?
Yeah, I mean, I think of course, a balance is, it has to be a balance, but I will go so far as to take a position and say that the balance has radically shifted. I mean, we simply are in a world where you can find out almost anything in a way that you couldn't.
I've got a counter argument. If you can find out almost anything, that becomes a commodity.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so how do you make yourself better?
Yeah, so then you need to cultivate a set of skills around, you know, processing information, filtering, learning, being curious. Of course, we need a base of knowledge, and of course, knowledge is important. But exactly as you say, it's been commoditized. And what that does is shift the balance more towards a skill set that's around acquisition of and processing of relevant knowledge. I mean, we were talking earlier, just very quickly, you know, my background is journalism. 20 years ago, there were old guys sitting in the newsroom, and literally their value is that they knew how to spell things like Reykjavik. And you would, you know, there would be some old guy sitting in the corner who, oh, I need the capital of Norway, and he would know. Okay?
Yeah, capital of Norway is easier than Reykjavik.
Now, that world has gone. So the balance of knowledge and skills has shifted, and there's no denying that.
Okay, Pear was eager to come in there, then we're going to go on to some more questions. And can we have the microphones ready to go with some questions from the audience as well? So Pear, you wanted to come in quickly?
I agree and not agree, because I'm a little bit confused. For instance, the Swedish government put up a new portal during the pandemic for workers that couldn't go to work, so they can study instead of building on their summer houses when they were not working. It's a good idea. So they invested millions and millions of Swedish kronor, because we're not a member of the euro, to build that portal. And I was visiting, giving a talk to their conclusion seminar for this 1.5 year project, costing millions and millions. And then I asked them a little bit, you know, what do you think about Skills Future, the portal in Singapore? And they say, what does it again? They have never heard about Skills Future that has been around with a portal, exactly looking the same as the one they built in Sweden. So there's knowledge out there, but people don't get it. It's the same thing with MOOCs. How come like 50% know about it? So Google will not help us with this. Even though it's out there, we don't get it, we don't understand it. So it's like both. Of course, there's knowledge out there, but how do you have the capability, the skill, the competences, the drive, and the openness to get it?
I'm going to wrap that up there, because this is a debate which I hope will continue for the next 2 days. I think it's a genuine debate, skills and knowledge. Where are we putting the emphasis? Where should we? I'm going to put my 2 cents in. I think creativity is a vital skill for the future, but I think you get that by joining the dots. If you haven't got any dots to join up, you're nowhere. And the dots are what we know. So I think we have to know stuff in order to be creative, in order to be flexible for the future. So I think it's both of them, but I think knowledge is crucial. But look, let's go down the bar later on and have a flash that one out over a beer, perhaps later on. I'm gonna ask one more question that came up from the floor, and then from the tweets, then we're gonna go out on the microphones. The whole AI bot, chatbot interface thing got people very excited. We do know that in 2016, Jill Watson was voted the top training assistant by students at Georgia Tech. Jill Watson, of course, was a bot. And they didn't know that when they were voting. So they just found there was a great training assistant who happened to be a series of algorithms. The question, though, and I'm going to pick up on Rob's framing for this. AI is great for answers. So if you've got a training assistant, it's great for providing answers. But shouldn't we, if we're helping people, helping students, shouldn't we be stimulating them to ask questions? Shouldn't we be challenging them? And can AI do that? David, from your experience, Horizon Scanning, what's your view? Then we'll come across the panel.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And I mean, I wholeheartedly agree with the general thrust of it. And I think fundamentally, I mean, it becomes complex quickly, but I think fundamentally my position on these AI conversational agents and their value, and I say this to all of the organizations I speak to, and I think the message pertains here as well, is that, you know, let's identify the domain that they play in effectively, and crucially, let's use that to liberate human beings, in this case, teachers and educators, to do what only they can do. If you think of this as a replacement, and I know a lot gets talked about, oh, but surely this can't be a replacement. You're crazy if you think this is a replacement. I never encounter anyone who truly thinks it is a replacement for contact with real humans. It's a bit of a red herring argument, because no one really believes it. But don't try to use this as a replacement. Use it as a tool and use that to liberate time and energy and passion in human beings to do what only they can do. And in this case, I think that's a great point. One of the things human teachers can do, and are so brilliant at, is fire the curiosity, fire the passion, get them asking the right questions. Yes, I think I agree with the thrust of that.
I love that. I'm going to take that as an answer from the panel as a whole, because Pear was noddling furiously while you were talking. and I just want to give a shout out to Joitske Hulsebosch, who I met in Next Learning in the Netherlands in 2018, who through her work and her research into bots gave me a whole insight into how this works. Her insight was actually very simple. I'll tell you about that if you challenge me afterwards. I'd like to go out to the audience. Do we have any microphones? Do we have any hands up with questions? Okay, we've got a hand up here. Could you sprint down to the front and pass the microphone here? Thank you so much. Do we have any other hands? If another hand goes up, we can get a microphone to you, and that would be great. Okay, can you just make sure somebody else is ready? Okay, go ahead.
Hello. Thanks very much for the excellent talks today and for the really good moderation of the session as well. My name's Sarah De Freitas. I'm director at the Digital Futures Institute in the UK. My question's really around identity, because we've talked a lot about different spaces, learning in physical spaces, learning in digital spaces, learning in virtual spaces. What does the panel think the implication of that will be for individual identities, multiple identities and other perspectives for how we learn?
So it's quite a broad question. Anybody want to jump in? Yeah, yeah. Thank you. Identity and learning, obviously we all have more than one identity. You're in a classroom, perhaps it's a simpler matter of dealing with it, but you're online or in a virtual space, it's a different matter. Any views on how technology and identity are going to play a role in the future?
Yeah, if I could take that, and also building on the previous comments around AI as well. I do think that with this tech-focused future, there's a lot of potential for reach and impact. But as mentioned, it really is about how we harness that potential and how we apply ourselves in response to those trends, because the risks are severe. So we know that there can be risks with socialization, mental health issues, cyberbullying, cybersecurity threats, and a whole range of other challenges that we're still to address in terms of broadening access across different spaces of learning. And I think with identity as well, it's both. There's massive opportunity for people to connect with their tribe, to connect with like-minded people. We've opened up the portals for collaboration. But at the same time, there's the threat of groupthink as well. There's a threat for identity to become compromised because we don't have the requisite support systems and mechanisms to facilitate these kinds of engagements. So I think that while we engage with opportunities available through AI and digital spaces, our intentional utilization of those opportunities is important. If we're not clever around it, then we might create more obstacles than potential. Yeah.
Thank you, Njeri, for that really complex answer. Any other thoughts?
Well, I totally agree. I run three different leadership programs between nations. Young leaders, at least from my side, 25 to 35, and they just hate when we do too much digital, too much hybrid, too much innovative. They would like to meet in person. They would like to travel together. Why? Because then, all of a sudden, you identify the identity on yourself in those circumstances, when the plane is late, and when you're hungry. And you identify your peers' identity and personality. That is really fruitful for creating that psychological safety that we need in order to grow as human beings. But I totally agree. I think I think we're quite lousy in really understanding where should we use the metaverse, AI, or whatever we should call everything that are innovative in that sense, and when should we use the plain old-fashioned in real life with modern smart pedagogics. I think it's maybe we're not courageous enough, or maybe we don't are open enough, or maybe we just don't study it enough. Mm. I think it's too less research on that, maybe. So to be conscious, when is the perfect thing for what?
Mm. And actually, to be conscious of it as an issue at all, I think, is really rather important. David, anything to add on the identity piece?
I think that intentional use of these technologies is obviously crucial. I talk a lot about democratized access in the metaverse. I think that's one of the opportunities it offers us. I mean, if you look at that NHS guys and St. Thomas's example I showed, you have literally the world's leading surgeon in the type of operation we were talking about, able to deliver an immersive training and learning experience to people on the other side of the world in a totally new way. There is the chance for these virtual worlds to democratize access to world-leading expertise in ways we haven't seen before. And some of the organizations I speak to are very interested in that. And I also say to them, look, this poses a challenge to you because there's no excuse for the CEO to not jump into virtual spaces with people on the front line of this organization. Use this technology to break the hierarchy of physical spaces and access that has structured your organization so far. That's an opportunity, but of course there are threats too.
The hierarchy can only be broken, of course, if there's also a culture of trust as well. It's not just about the technology. Let's go. Thank you so much. We've got 5 minutes left. I'm going to go for one question here. I'm going to ask for your wrap-up. So this question here, I'm hoping it's a super concise, easy question, which everyone can answer in 30 seconds. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, it's not an easy question. I applaud all the technological developments, but my concern is as we develop here in the developed Western countries, we enlarge the gap with the underprivileged countries. How do we make sure that we share that technology with the underprivileged countries, developing countries, so that they can also have some positive development in their countries?
That is actually a really good question. I've made a note of something like that to answer. Thank you very much. I think it's a really important question to ask. I'm going to summarize it, put it to the panel. They are at the moment, I can see, over my shoulder, thinking up brilliant answers in 30 seconds to answer this one. There's a danger the technology enhances and stretches inequity rather than gapping it, rather than reducing the gap. And Jerry, you talked about the 2 billion people with no internet access. How do we ameliorate? How do we reduce that risk? How can we make it reduce inequity rather than growing it in 30 seconds? I'm sorry, that's what we've got. Go ahead.
Thank you. So I think we need to think about it in both ways, right? If we're thinking around multiple possible futures and being contextually relevant, then we have to assume that even in digitally disconnected spaces, that there's learning going on there as well. And what can we learn from those spaces to influence our digital connection? But I do think knowledge transfer is a two-way street. And again, intentional engagement with opportunities to ensure that we're exchanging this knowledge across our context and keeping open to multiple possible futures, not one tech-driven future from a developing world context, but rather being open to the multiple possibilities across.
And Jerry, thank you for that. It is not a matter of, if I understand you correctly, sharing technology, but rather of developing a dialogue and growing together. Per.
Well, I've been working in UN and in other NGOs on the border to Kenya, as we talked about. And we need to educate NGOs about what's possible out there, because they are super traditional. They don't know about you guys.
Just the NGOs are super.
Yes, all NGOs, almost, with very few exceptions. They are not aware of how technology can used as a cascade effect for learning in the development world.
And how it's already being used. Great examples already, particularly in Africa, of mobile technology being used, for example. David.
Yeah, all I'd add is that the era of digital technology we've lived through for the last 20 years has been incredibly centralized. So I'm conscious that the examples I showed come from huge, powerful, centralized technology platforms like Google and Meta. And I would love to see a wave of innovation now, a revolution, dare I say it, from the ground up, huge global technology platforms built and owned and controlled by the people at scale, by millions or hundreds of millions of people. Some people think blockchains can help with that. I think we need to think more about that. But a revolution in technology where we share the technology we own rather than it being owned by a tiny number of people in Silicon Valley can play a role here.
It's a great question. Thank you so much. And I love the answers. It's about sharing. It's about a two-way street. And it's not about centralization from Europe, but rather of us working together. So great question. Thank you for the answers. We've got, I'm looking at the clock here. It's got a countdown. 1 minute, 20 seconds. And I've got to ask our panelists our final question. Everyone's going to go, you're going to have a great 2 days. You're going to go home. Monday morning, you're back in the office. What does everybody do? Very quickly. Back in the office, Monday morning, one thing to kickstart the future. Njeri.
Build on the conversations and networks from this conference. Don't let the dynamic die. Keep it active.
Don't let the dynamic die. Thank you.
Yeah. Ask yourself the four questions I showed you about your learning mindset, and then take those four questions to your colleagues.
Right. And David?
Decide to become your own trend watcher. Go out into the world looking at it in a structured way. Find innovation examples that are unlocking new ways to serve the deep human need that is education, that is learning and knowledge and curiosity. If you take that out into the world, you will start to spot trends of your own that you can bring back and use, do something with.
So, share, challenge yourself, and look to the horizon. What a great message to take into the next 2 days of the conference and indeed for afterwards. I want you now, please, as we've got 6 seconds left, give a 6 second round of applause to our panel. All right. Thank you so much.